This is Pete Feenstra from www.getreadytorock.com, talking to the iconic rock vocalist, Mr. Ian Gillan.
Good morning.
We're live in Shepherd's Bush. He's been doing interviews since breakfast, but hopefully we've still got a bit to get out of you.
Tons of stamina.
Great to hear it. Ian, it's been 12 years, I think, since Dreamcatcher, is that right?
Yeah.
What took you so long to come up with the new solo album?
Well, in order to improve on Dreamcatcher, I needed to find some musicians, a budget, a producer, and a record company. So we managed to get all of those in place. Sadly, Roger Glover's mum became ill last year, and we cancelled a couple of Deep Purple tours while he could spend her last days with her. And so I took myself off to Buffalo and got working on this. I had about 38, 40 songs in the library in various stages of completion. So the most difficult thing was actually the selection process. Normally, it's the writing on an album that takes all the time and stress and strain, but this was just really a question of selection of the material.
I was going to ask you about a little bit later, but I'll ask you now, the 30-odd songs that you had, did they go back a long way, or were they something you've been working on more recently?
All but one. They were all written over 4 or 5 years, the last four or 5 years, which in my lifetime is fairly recent.
Yeah. Absolutely. And of course, the title track kick-started the whole...
The track itself was, before it was titled, musically it was the key, the cornerstone, the keystone to the whole thing. I'd always felt something very special about this track since I wrote it with Steve Morris, and so that was the criterion by which all the others were judged. And if they went with that, then they were on the album. If they didn't, then they were back in the library for something else.
And it started with a phrase.
It's a Polish phrase. I was on a winter vacation there with a friend, and we had done the usual sightseeing thing in Cracow, the salt mines, and I was in, went to the Jewish quarter, and we went to Schindler's café, and he was explaining the activities of Oscar Schindler during the Second World War. And a beautiful woman walked behind him, and I just followed her, lost completely what he was talking about, and just followed her with my, until she drifted out of the door on her own personal cloud of musk. It was, anyway, sorry Tommy, what were you saying? He said, Ian, you have one eye to Morocco, which means you've got a wandering eye, but the full expression in Polish is you have one eye to Morocco and the other to the Caucasus, which literally means you're looking in two directions at the same time. More philosophically, I suppose, it can mean while you're at work or school, you're dreaming about your, you know, the football match or the party you're going to. So I thought it was a fine musical metaphor, really, with the Caucasus being Deep Purple and Morocco being my naughty weekend away, so to speak.
So it's a phrase or a lyric that often kick-starts your songs?
Normally lyrics are the last thing.
Really?
Yeah, I normally sing gibberish. I call it gibberish. When we're working with Purple, we start from scratch. Or when I'm working with any other songwriters, we come up with the idea, and it's always the tune, the arrangement. And for me, the words is the most important thing to kickstart a song, is that the words have got to sound good before they mean anything. It's really got to get the percussive value of the whole thing. And so I just really come up with a load of rubbish and use the voice to create the kind of sound of lyric that I would like.
So in the case of co-writing with both Steve Morris and many, many years ago with Colin Towns, was it the case that they would come up with a musical format, or do you have any input into that as well?
Everyone's different, you know, everyone has their own ways of doing things. Colin would get things fairly complete, fairly complete. Colin would like to have written the whole song himself.
That's often
in
the
some
case
he does, because he's very good with melodies and that sort of thing. So most people, when they come up with a structure, they like to think of the where the melody's going or where the tune's going.